Sure. So I work for a company that provides dialysis care to patients with chronic kidney disease, whose kidneys basically no longer function. And so what I do in the organization, I work in the medical office. And so we do. There's really three things that we do, but one of them is related to the predictive analytics and advanced analytics. The other area is related to publications and research, and then the third one is more routine and custom analytics that we do across various parts of the organization. That's correct. So let me just tell you a little bit about the, I think, Fresenius Medical Care and what we do. So there's about 500,000 patients here in the U.S. and a similar proportion also in the U.K. or anywhere on the world whose kidneys no longer function. And so they can still live, but their kidneys no longer function. And so what you do in that case is there's this therapy that's been created where patients go for something called dialysis, which, as I always say, I hope, you know, nobody who is on that therapy, but if you do, then that's what we do, and it's a renal replacement therapy. And it's something that you do 3 times a week for the remainder of your life. What that does mean is it's something that's very intensive. You know, you have to continue going for this treatment 3 times a week for 4 hours each time. From a data perspective, that becomes very unique because we're collecting a lot of data on our patients. You know, there's really nowhere else, to the best of my knowledge, in medicine where you see a person 3 times a week, you collect all their laboratory, you collect all their clinical information, and this may be going on for anywhere between a couple of years, but also 10 or 20 years. So imagine you have a person who you've been following for 20 years where you have all their blood pressure measurements, all their weights, all their heart rates, and so on and so forth, routinely for many, many years. So it opens this opportunity to be able to build some predictive models that you can actually avoid some negative outcomes happening to the patient by predicting some of these events and hopefully avoiding them, having some clinical interventions to avoid those. Yeah, so that's a great question. So actually one of the interesting things that we've been doing is we've actually because we have a few statisticians and a few people who are able to do these predictive analytics. First of all, one of the things about our predictive analytics is that even though we do it within the company, we also have some other parts of the organization. For instance, we have one of our subsidiaries who is very, very heavy into predictive analytics and into advanced data modeling. So we really tap into, we don't just do it, let's say, in my group only, but we really try to tap into various parts of the organization to be able to do these predictive analytics. And we've set up the other thing I should mention is that we also have been very keen on setting up a process around how we do these predictive analytics. So when somebody comes to us with a request, let's say somebody wants to predict something, and it does not have to be clinical to answer your question. It could be, for instance, our human resources organization may be interested in knowing which of our employees will resign from the organization. And so one of the things they do is they would actually come to us with this predictive analytics request, and we have what we call predictive analytics steering committee, and we filter those requests, we prioritize them, and then we have somebody work on them. And so finally, to get to your question, we've actually gotten requests from all kinds of parts of the organization. So we have questions like, well, can we predict somebody going to the hospital, one of our patients? But we also have questions, can we predict which of our employees, as I said, will resign the organization, or which of our patients will not show up for their dialysis treatment because they don't feel like it on that particular day? So we've been very, I would say we've been very wide reach in terms of where we apply our predictive analytics. And I think, you know, a lot of times it's really, one of the things I think in business, it's hard to get acceptance in all areas of the organization of this idea of actually running predictive analytics. So I think it's been very important to us to really work with the partners that are also willing to test those things out with us. And so, you know, eventually I think that these ideas, when we see the benefit of these predictive analytics, I think they become more, they proliferate more throughout the organization. So. So I think the steering committee, it's a group of our medical leads, it's also our business leads, it's also our statistical people. You know, we don't want to put something on a request to build a predictive model, and we don't have any data, or there's no methods to be able to run the model. So we really try to be all-encompassing in this steering committee. We meet on a bi-monthly basis as a team, and the purpose of the steering committee, there's a couple of them. So the first one is to prioritize these requests that may be coming through, but then the second one is also to see how each individual request is doing in its, in its life trajectory, basically, from the time we got the request to the time the model is created, and then how does the model actually do once it's being utilized? Is it doing what it's supposed to do? Are we actually improving, be it patient outcomes, or be it, are we reducing the termination rate of our employees because we're now able to keep the employees longer because we realize that some employees are likely to resign? And so the way the steering committee works is as follows. The request comes in. Anybody in the organization can say, you know what, Len or whoever it is in the organization, we would like to be able to predict X. And then when we meet during our bi-monthly meetings, we ask that whoever the requester is, we will ask them for a brief summary of what they're looking for. And then we would sit down and we would ask everybody to rank everybody on the steering committee, and there's about 10 people, as I mentioned. It's clinical people, but it's also operational people, and it's also business people and the statisticians. We ask everybody to rank each one of these requests. It's fairly straightforward. And then depending on where it comes in on the ranking, that's how we know what to go with first. I mean, everybody has limited resources, and so do we. So I think that's really how we do it. And then what we rank it based is really two. I mean, there's a number of questions on the ranking, but it's really two things. It's will the outcome of this model actually have an impact on the organization? That's the first one. I mean, if this is purely a scientific exercise, I think we wouldn't be doing this, or at least not in this forum, not in the formal operational forum. So that's the first question. And then the second one is, can we actually build the model? So do we have the data to do it? Are we trying to predict something that there's absolutely no data on, so there's really no point of doing it? So that's how we do it. We rank the model, and then we assign some internal resources to run the model. And it's also, we found it very important to have a business lead who is interested in this project, who is very connected to the project, because it also requires, I mean, the modeling aspect of it is only a piece of this huge puzzle, I think, right? I mean, the data pieces and the predictive model is only one piece. Then how do you actually utilize it? If you know the patient is not going to show up for treatment, what do you actually do with this information? If you know the employee is going to likely to resign tomorrow, what do you actually do with this stuff? So there's a lot of other components to it, way beyond, I think, what we just do on the analytical side. In dialysis, there's this, we have, as I may have mentioned, we have about 2,200 dialysis clinics in the U.S. They're like freestanding dialysis clinics. Think of like a freestanding Starbucks, except that we're actually doing heavy-duty therapy in these freestanding organizations around the country. They're not hospitals. They're these little freestanding units where patients come in for a treatment, where their blood gets transfused, and they usually work almost, 18, 16-hour days. And so one of the key roles in that organization is in these dialysis clinics is something called a PCT. It's a technician, basically. And the technicians do a lot of work with, for instance, they cannulate what's called a fistula. They do a lot of work with the patient when the patients show up. I mean, think of it, if you go to a doctor's office, it's like a technician who's there in the doctor's office, the same idea. So we hire, I don't know the exact number off the top of my head, but it's definitely in the tens of thousands of those that we have working in our clinics. And so their turnover rate is very, very high, particularly in the first year when they start working with us. I can't really quote the exact number, but a lot of them will leave the organization in the first year. And so what are some of the predictors? How do we know the person is more likely to leave within the first year? Well, the types of things we look at are as follows. First of all, we look at some of their pre-hire assessments. We have people fill out some questionnaires. So that's one thing. Then we also look at, we found that where you are actually matters. We found that other things around the person actually matters. For example, just to mention, We know that if it's a, how many hours a week is the person going to work? You know, is this somebody who's coming in just to fill in a spot, or is this somebody who's coming in full time? You know, that makes a difference. So there's quite a lot of, I mean, there's probably 20 or 30 different predictors that go into the model. For instance, is the clinic, you know, how is the clinic itself doing? Is this a clinic where there's a high NPS, this what's called net promoter score of all the employees? Are the people who work in that clinic, are they actually happy or are they not happy? You know, that gives you quite a lot of predictive power over whether somebody will resign fairly quickly after starting in the organization. What is the clinic manager, who is basically like the, you know, the general manager of that clinic, what are they like? How, you know, who's that person? Is that position filled? You know, we know that clinics with no leader, you know, don't do as well in terms of retaining their employees. So those are some of the things that we're putting into the model. And so it is, you know, part of the exercise is the whole data collection piece. I mean, there's no question it's like trying to get this data, and, you know, lots of time is being spent on actually data cleaning and, you know, data manipulation a lot, you know, unfortunately, too much to, you know, in my taste, but that's what ends up happening, unfortunately. So I think very carefully, and that's, I think, one of the key things to me, actually, in, you know, when we talk about predictive analytics or, you know, all these data analytics, I think being very smart about how you actually use it, you know, who do you portray the results to, how do you portray them is, you know, and it's not one of these things that you just roll it out, you know, like a tank and you give the same information to everybody. I think it has to be very much customized. There are people who are non-data believers. And they believe in the more traditional approaches, and there's nothing wrong with that. I mean, I think I always say predictive analytics is nothing more than it's additive. It gives you something a little more than what you didn't already have, hopefully. And, you know, in any organization, you'll have some people who are definitely non-believers. So in our case, I think we provide the information, and it's very customized. You know, in some areas, we'll say, you know, we should be looking at those employees a little bit more carefully. You should be understanding why they want to resign. In some cases, maybe we should be thinking about what's actually happening in that clinic, that people should be, you know, maybe there's something actually wrong in the clinic, that people are resigning left and right, that it's not just this employee is resigning. It's, you know, the whole clinic has some issues that need to be addressing. And I can certainly tell you that our HR organization is spending enormous amounts of time in really making sure that these issues are resolved and that these employees are happy. Yeah, so I think, you know, this certainly varies tremendously from an analytic from one analytics organization to another. I mean, our team certainly has some very diverse experiences. You know, we do have, first of all, my group is fairly small. It's only about 10 people. And I think in that group, we have people who are pure statisticians and pure data analysts. But we also have people who are medical writers, and they know everything about medical concept, but they don't necessarily know as much about the, you know, the data analytics piece of it. And so I think it's very important to kind of cross-pollinate all the, you know, the different people in the group. You know, I'm actually very proud that we have, sometimes, you know, some people may say we're a little, you know, crazy because we have these people with all different specialties, but I actually think there's a lot of benefit. I mean, we have a couple of data scientists in our group. We do have, a couple of pure medical writers, pure clinical people, but we also have people with statistics and mathematics as their background. And I think really, you know, also making sure that people who do these analyses, they actually understand what the business question is that's involved. And I don't necessarily, I say business very generally here. I mean, it could be an HR question. It's not really a business question. So I think it's just very important that people understand what exactly they're doing, and, you know, be it sending people to spend time in the dialysis clinic to make sure that they understand what is it like to actually operate in a dialysis clinic. You know, I think that has a tremendous, tremendous value. And so that's, I find that very important. Well, I think, do you want three or do you just want, I mean, in my mind, I think there's one that is absolutely overarchingly important. And I think that one is really being able to connect the dots. And being able to, you know, you could be a super advanced mathematician, but leading the team, and I think you will do great technically, but I think you will, chances are we won't be able to translate that message. So I think that really the knowledge that spans, you know, many, many different surfaces is very, very important. I think that's one. I think the other one is, you know, you do hire people of different backgrounds, and so I think it's very important to be culturally sensitive to the people that you hire, at least certainly in the U.S. I mean, there's a lot of people in the data analytics field, you know, who don't necessarily come from the U.S., and I think it's very important to be able to be very culturally cognizant of who you actually hire in the team. And then the third one, you know, I would say the third one is making sure that everybody, that the leader should be really thinking about everybody in the team individually, and how do the people in the team don't necessarily get bored with what they're doing, that they're continuing to learn and gain new skills, because I think we're, you know, we're in an extremely rapidly moving field here with data analytics and, you know, predictive modeling. So.